The scene, Chicago Stadium. The event, the opening game of the 1971 Stanley Cup Finals. The teams, Montreal Canadiens, third place finishers in the National Hockey League's East Division, and Chicago Blackhawks, first in the West. The prize, the championship of the NHL, and North America's oldest and most coveted trophy in professional team sport, the Stanley Cup. But before game one gets underway, let's see how the Blackhawks and the Canadiens got to the finals. Number nine, Bobby Hull, played a vital role for Chicago. In the quarterfinals against the Philadelphia Flyers, his 6 goals and 2 assists led the Blackhawks to victory in 4 straight games. And Hull, the Golden Jet, was just as important in the semifinals against New York Rangers. This was a very evenly matched series that went the full 7 games, 3 of them going into overtime. New York won 2 of those overtime games, both on goals by Pete Stemkowski. Hull scored the other overtime winner, as well as the winning goal in the final game. In the meantime, the Canadiens pulled off one of the biggest upsets ever in the NHL playoffs. They surprised everybody by ousting Boston in their opening round. The powerful Bruins were winners of the NHL's East Division and boasted 4 players, each with over 100 points. Phil Esposito, number 7, with a record-smashing 76 goals and 76 assists. Bobby Orr with a record-setting 102 assists. Johnny Busick, 51 goals. And Kenny Hodge, another 100-point man. But Montreal conquered the awesome Bruins in 7 games. And rookie Ken Dryden, who had played in only 6 regular-season NHL games prior to these playoffs, proved to be the key to Canadiens' stunning upset. Montreal met the Minnesota North Stars and was favored to take the Stars in the minimum 4 games. But before this semifinal series was over, Minnesota had defeated the Canadiens twice. The first wins in the playoffs by an original West Division club over an established East Division team. The North Stars were put out in 6, but the Canadiens had to struggle to do it. Thus, the stage was set for this dramatic final series between the explosive Blackhawks and the Cinderella Canadiens, who'd missed the playoffs only the season before. Chicago started fast. In the first period, they peppered 18 shots at Dryden, but the 6-foot-4-inch Cornell graduate wasn't performing like a rookie. Tony Esposito, a Michigan Tech graduate, made some equally brilliant saves, but not nearly as often as Dryden, who faced 58 shots in this battle of the goaltenders. Going into the third period, Canadians were ahead 1-0 on a power play goal by Jacques Lemaire, but Chicago ties the score on this play by Bobby Hull. And Hull seems to be on the ice all the time. It was still tied 1-1 at the end of regulation time. Chicago came out surprisingly strong in the first overtime period, but it wasn't until 1:11 of the second overtime period that Jim Papin, number 8, scored the winning goal. The Blackhawks win 2-1 to take a 1-game lead in the final. Game 2 was less than 5 minutes old when Bobby Hull unleashed this blinding slap shot. It was obvious that if Canadians were going to stop Chicago, they'd have to stop Hull first. Hull and Frank Mahovlich, who scored this goal later in the game, were battling for the playoff scoring leadership, and their names, along with Dryden, were being mentioned as the Stanley Cup playoff's most valuable player. Less than a minute later, Big John Beliveau, number 4, ties up 2 defensemen to create a traffic jam in front of Esposito, and the diminutive Cornwallier slides a backhander under Jarrett and Esposito to tie the score. In the second period, Pete Mahovlich beats Esposito on this superb effort to give Montreal a 2-1 lead to the delight of the Montreal fans. It was tied again 2-2 on this quick wrist shot by Chico Mackin. 68 seconds later, the Hawks seem to apply the crusher when Papin scores on another magnificent effort to give Chicago a 3-2 lead. Chicago's Billy Ray, the dean of NHL coaches, and his players were flying high. They had outplayed the Canadiens for two periods. Now it's the third period, and despite those powerful television lights beaming down on the ice, things did not look very bright for Montreal. Buzz around the Canadiens, but the star of this game was utility centerman Lou Engotti, who usually gets off the bench for only occasional shifts. Engotti, number six, wound up with two goals and two assists and was dealt the super sub as Chicago down Montreal 5-3. Now the Blackhawks were firmly in the driver's seat, only two wins away from the Stanley Cup. As the series shifted to Montreal, the Canadiens were faced with the seemingly impossible task of winning four out of five games. Back in their familiar Montreal Forum, wearing their home ice white uniforms, the Canadiens stayed with rookie Dryden, who wasn't faulted for the previous two losses. Dryden was sensational in the first period, yet the Canadiens came out trailing 2-0. And it was beginning to look as if Chicago could wrap things up in four games. Cliff Coral, number 20, and Bobby Hull scored the Chicago goal. However, Montreal was playing a much more offensive game here on home ice. And in the second period, the Mihajlovic brothers got the Canadiens back in contention. That bank shot off Esposito's pad by number 20, Pete, made it 2-1. And watch as Frank, number 27, ties the game with a devastating slap shot. This rush by defenseman Terry Harper eventually results in the winning goal. Watch in super slow motion as Yvan Cornoyer takes Harper's pass and lines up his target. Frank Mihajlovic added another goal before the siren to make the final score 4-2. And now the Canadiens trail Chicago 2-1. Canadiens started fast again in this fourth game. The Mihajlovic brothers were taking up right where they left off. In the first minute of the game, Pete deflected Harper's long shot to give Montreal a 1-0 lead. Number 21, Stan Mikita, got that one back soon after. Then Montreal captain Jean Beliveau shot his team into the lead to stay. Before the period ended, Guy Lapointe made it 3-1, and suddenly the complexion of the series had changed, and the Canadiens were definitely back in contention. Number 12, Yvan Cornoyer, added two more goals. And Reja Hull, number 14, covered Bobby Hull so well that the Golden Jet got only two shots on goal. The final score was 5-2, and now it's back to Chicago with a series tied at 2-1. Neither club has lost in its own arena so far, and the capacity crowd of Chicago fans are confident their Hawks will regain their winning ways here on home ice. Chicago goes to the attack as Dennis Hull has a good close-in chance. Obviously, Lapointe wasn't going to give him a second try. And the Canadiens storm back at Esposito, who makes big stops on John Ferguson. On Richard, and then on Cornwallier. The Hawks had some good chances, but Dryden continues to play sensationally. Nobody can recall a Stanley Cup final which saw such spectacular goalkeeping at both ends of the rink. Bobby Hull passes to Coral. Let's watch in super slow motion as Coral hits Dennis Hull in full flight and the puck goes high, up under the crossbar and then down into the net. The first period ends with Chicago leading 1-0. Hit Martin, number 7, attempts to make it 2-0, but Dryden gets some help from the goalpost. Then number 2, Bill White, drives one from the blue line. Makita gets the puck behind the goal. Out in front it comes to Coral, and he makes it 2-0. In super slow motion, we see that Makita's pass-out went to Denisov, who blasted a shot which rebounded right to Coral, and Coral puts in a perfect shot just inside the post. Here comes the defensive play of the game. On this breakaway, watch as Bobby Hull knocks the puck away from Frank Mahovlich. Goalies made some unbelievable saves for the rest of this period. But neither Esposito nor Dryden was giving an inch as the period ended with Chicago ahead 2-0. In the third period, rookie coach Al McNeil continued to switch around his lines. In fact, he used 22 different forward combinations in this game. This night it didn't matter because the Canadians just couldn't get the puck past Tony Esposito, who put his second shutout of the playoffs. Once again, the Blackhawks held the upper hand as they took the lead 3-2. Game 6 in Montreal, and it was do or die for the Canadians. But tradition was on their side because in their illustrious history, Montreal Canadiens have never lost the Stanley Cup on their own ice. Early in the game, Frank Mahovlich races Tony Esposito for a loose puck. Referee Art Skov signals a penalty shot, calling Esposito for throwing his stick. Now let's watch the infraction again in slow motion. Esposito throws the stick, and the Canadians are awarded a penalty shot, the first in the Stanley Cup Finals in 27 years. Now the penalty shot. Mahovlich circles. Esposito readies himself for a head-on confrontation with one of the game's greatest goal scorers. The big end shoots. Esposito makes the save. One can't help but wonder how demoralizing an effect that crucial save would have on the Canadians. The save, on the other hand, gave Chicago a big lift, and the Hawks stormed Montreal's goal. Moments later, Jim Papin races out of his own end and is about to score on one of the most artistic goals of the playoffs to give Chicago a 1-0 lead. You won't see many like that, so let's see it again. Goal, but Dryden has lots of life left in him yet. He may be down, but he's not out. And more important, the puck's not in. That shot off the post by the Golden Jet would have made it 4-2. But instead, Frank Mahovlich gives the Canadians new life with this tying goal, his 14th of the playoffs for a new. The slow-motion camera shows that Esposito made the original save, but Big Frank trucked his rebound inside the post just before Stapleton could get there to clear. Now it was Montreal's turn to fly. 3 minutes later, while killing a penalty, Pete Mahovlich broke in on Esposito, and that was it. Montreal won 4-3, forcing a seventh and deciding game back in Chicago. 20,000 fans jammed Chicago Stadium to see this final game of perhaps the most exciting and dramatic Stanley Cup playoffs in NHL history. Because of the excitement, the CBS television network preempted its prime time regular programming to carry this game. That, coupled with the two Canadian television networks, enabled more than 25 million viewers to see hockey at its best. The game opens with a great offensive move by Hull, but somehow Dryden manages to keep the puck out. Esposito comes out to cut down the angle on Frank Mahovlich. It was one big save after another. During the first period, both goalies made saves that were nothing short of miraculous. In the final minutes of the first period, watch as Dennis Hull, number 10, beats Dryden from an unlikely angle to give Chicago a 1-0 lead. The big question in this game was, would home ice continue to be the deciding factor? Both teams have won every game on their home ice so far. Martin centers the puck to O'Shea. He knocks it down, gets control, and fires it home. And it's 2-0 for the Blackhawks at 7:33 of the second period. Only the crossbar saves Dryden on that blast by Bobby Hull. Chicago seemed to be completely in control until Lemaire surprised everybody, including Esposito, with a bullet-like shot from just over center ice, and the complexion of the game started to change. That unexpected goal makes it 2-1, with slightly over 5 minutes left to play in the second period. Happen at the side of the net misses an excellent chance to put Chicago further ahead, but a minute and 40 seconds before the second period ended, Richard had tied the score 2-2. Now it's down to the final 20 minutes of this tense drama, and the tension mounts. Poole fights for the puck. Feeds it to Ferguson, but Esposito makes the stop. Canadians are carrying the attack. That's Henry Richard going in on left wing. He manages to elude Magnuson's diving check and shoots the puck over the falling Esposito. Montreal goes ahead 3-2. Now the pressure is on Chicago. They have to attack, and this save on Papin is typical of the way Dryden is frustrating the Blackhawks. Chicago's best chance to tie the score came when Papin again was stopped by Dryden, this time with a fantastic leg save. Time is running out, And Esposito is trying to get to the bench for a sixth attacker, but Poole and Ferguson force Coney to stay in his goal. Less than a minute remaining. Esposito races to the bench, and Chicago sends six men into the Canadian zone. Pete Mihaljevic clears the puck down ice. Only seconds remain. Here comes Makita. Over to Martin. He loses control, and the puck comes out of the Montreal end. And the game is over. The Montreal Canadiens have won the Stanley Cup for a record 16th time. These great Chicago fans stand to cheer the champions and their valiant Blackhawks. As the players exchange congratulatory handshakes, the tension and fatigue shows in the face of Henry Richard, who tonight let his actions speak louder than his words. NHL President Clarence Campbell presents the Stanley Cup to Captain Jean Beliveau, his 10th Stanley Cup, a record he shares with Richard. In the dressing room, the Canadians were exhausted but happy. They'd given their all on the ice. Nobody could blame them for being weary. And Beliveau tugged off his sweater for the final time. Soon after this victory parade, the 39-year-old Beliveau, one of the greatest names in the NHL, announced his retirement. But Montreal fans had a new young hero in their midst, 23-year-old rookie goaltending sensation, Ken Dryden, the playoffs' most valuable player. Coach McNeil rode with Canadiens president David Molson and the 500,000 proud citizens of Montreal who turned out to pay tribute to their beloved Canadiens, so jammed the streets that it took 2.5 hours to go only 2 miles. But who cares? The Cup was back in Montreal.